I remember the night that these arrived. We picked them up in Kansas and flew them into Stead here. It was dark when they arrived, and that was the beginning of our heavy lift helicopter mission.
To know it is to love it, and anybody who flies it is welcome to call it ugly, and I accept that. The real beauty of the aircraft is that it has the best safety record of any of the helicopters in the Army inventory, which is unusual considering some of the situations we put it in and some of the things we asked this aircraft to do.
I love this aircraft because it's easy to work on. You don't have any cowling to pull off. It's everything's right out in the open. Each aircraft develops kind of its own personality.
I've been in the crane for 22 years now, and I have never enjoyed another aircraft as much as the crane. I feel more comfortable in this aircraft than in anything else that I fly. And it just seems to be part of what I do, and I have to say that I will miss the aircraft. We've used it down low, we've done special operations, recovering aircraft, putting up statues to putting up bridges. The aircraft has never failed to come through when we've asked to perform its task.
This is the CH-54, affectionately known as the Skycrane. For almost 30 years, the crane has been a fixture here in Nevada and across the country. It has fought forest fires, lifted debris from the top of Mount Rushmore. It's placed a statue on the very peak of the Rocky Mountains, and even lifted the world's largest frying pan and dropped it into a stadium in an attempt to make the world's largest omelet. A lot of people have called it the praying mantis, a flying insect. Some have even called it ugly. Well, no matter, for soon the CH-54 Alpha will be nothing more than a memory. Soon, the last of these venerable aircraft will lift off on its final mission to the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C. The Skycrane, long the workhorse of the U.S. Army, is being decommissioned. An era has come to an end. By its very design, the CH-54, well, it hardly seems the stuff of which legends are made. From here, you don't get the feeling of excitement that seems to surround other aircraft. There's little of the romance that usually accompanies a, let's say, a stirring liftoff from a carrier at sea or a daring troop landing in the midst of chilling enemy fire. In fact, the Skycrane looks awkward and more than a little bit fragile. Nonetheless, the Skycrane could do what no other aircraft in the world could ever do. The Skycrane, the CH-54, could do the impossible.
In Vietnam, the infantryman, as he has been through history, is still the backbone of our defense and offense. He walks, he patrols through tangled, treacherous terrain. He scouts for and skirmishes with an enemy who is both everywhere and nowhere, who is here today, flushed out tomorrow, and returns to ambush on the next day. But in this war, as in no other war, the foot soldier is supported by a second army. Motorized and mechanized, made up of an infinite variety of weapons, machines, vehicles, and aircraft. Their mission, to provide mobility, the rapid deployment of men and materiel.
most of us that were flying the CH-54 in 1970 and 71 had been to Vietnam at least once previously. Some were on their third tour flying over there. And that was probably for the best, because there was a pretty good experience base of older hands who had 1,000 or 2,000 hours. And for the mission that we were performing with the CH-54 in Vietnam at that time, it took that kind of experience level to pull it off.
The crane, with its unique capabilities and tremendous lifting power, would be ordained by fire in the jungles of Vietnam. The conflict required the swift movement of entire units, infantry, armor, even medical.
Well, we did a couple of things to help prevent getting shot at. Almost every time we left with the crane, we had a gun team of Cobras, of gunships that would protect and escort the aircraft whenever it went into an area that was particularly hostile. And the Cobras were the ones that would keep everybody's heads down while we went in and did what we had to do. The other technique that I developed and used quite often was, once we got rid of the load, this aircraft will climb vertically about 62 miles an hour. And frequently we'd see tracer fire coming at us, but would be underneath because they wouldn't really understand how to lead the aircraft and shoot at it because we were traveling so fast vertically. And we would just keep on climbing until we were too high for them to shoot at us anymore. And we could sit back and relax and look for our next mission. Most of it was those long stretches of boredom interspersed with periods of panic and mayhem. Like any other tour, it was a particularly satisfying tour because we did recovery work. We went out and supported soldiers, recovered aircraft that had been shot down or broken down. And I think we did constructive things, putting in bridges, hauling food, that kind of thing, rather than the destructive missions that the Army's probably more known for.